It was just a few keystrokes. A couple of sentences on a computer screen. On November 27th, 2007, right around Thanksgiving, the severely autistic Aislinn Wendrow is describing her weekend and types this on her computer at school. My dad gets me up. He puts his hands on my private parts. Wendrow's lives would never be the same.
There was a message on the answering machine, and I listened to it. He said there's been this allegation. It's indescribable. Wow!
You tell me.
Before this, the Wendrows were convinced Aislinn had achieved a kind of miracle using a therapy called facilitated communication, or FC. A technique where a trained person using a special grip supposedly helps Aislinn move her hand to the letters so she can type out her thoughts. But that was before she entered high school and got a new facilitator named Cindy Scarcella.
Of all the people who had ever done facilitated communication with Aislinn, she knew the least about it. She sat through 1 hour, she said, of unpaid training.
1 hour.
1 hour.
That was enough for Scarcella to facilitate those sex allegations and everything to follow.
The allegations were just horrific, the kind of story you know would keep you up at night.
Lori Brazer of the Detroit Free Press covered the story from the very start. She says the school reported the allegations and the prosecutor's office sprang into action. She says that was their reputation with sex cases.
There was this sense that they'd never met a child who hadn't been molested. If an allegation was made, they would charge immediately.
Did they have forensics?
No.
Did they have statements from any other adults?
No.
They have anything they found in the house?
They had nothing. They had nothing.
What was the case based on?
The case was based on Aislinn's allegations, supposed allegations.
Aislinn, the autistic child who can't speak.
Right.
Okay. Has she used these before?
Now, it's just 2 days after Aislinn made those somewhat vague allegations at school. She enters this room at a special county agency where investigators hope she'll provide more details. They're watching what goes on from behind a glass.
Well, my name's Amy, and my job is to talk with kids about things that have happened.
A forensic interviewer is on the right side of the screen. On the left is the facilitator, Cindy Scarcella.
I want you to tell me everything that happened last weekend.
The Wendrows, as well as experts in FC, had advised investigators to bring in another facilitator who knew nothing about what Aislinn was claiming. But that doesn't happen.
His penis is in you, and he's kissing you.
And now, with her help, Aislinn's allegations are mushrooming. The story's becoming more sensational. They type that sexual abuse went on since Aislinn was six, and that Tali did nothing. That Julian has taken photos, even forced her younger brother Ian to take part.
Okay, so your dad makes your brother touch him and you in your private parts.
The accusations are shocking if they are Aislinn's words, and investigators believe they are. They accept FC in large part because they say Julian and Tali did. But the Wendrows realize now they've been deceiving themselves all along.
And we had to swallow a pretty bitter pill. It became pretty clear that this was, that we were wrong.
They believed in FC more than anybody else.
So what? You know, a parent will try anything, and, you know, if they think it's going to help the child, they're the parent. It's the police's job to figure out whether she's reliable and whether a crime has been committed.
The authorities often get criticized because they don't follow up on allegations. Here, they did the opposite.
Mm-hmm.
They went after it. They were aggressive, thorough.
If they were thorough, I wouldn't be sitting here talking to you. This was, I have a charge, this guy's guilty, we're going to set about trying to hang him. Don't bother us with the facts.
And Gordon says alarms should have been going off during that very same interview. Listen to these incredible mistakes.
What's Grandma's name? Her name's Julie.
Aislinn and Scarcella type out her grandma's name is Julie. It is Betty. They say Aislinn's dog's name is Henry. It's actually Nelson.
At each stage, it became more ridiculous. I mean, crazy things that to them was meaningless because they had a really good story here and they were running with it.
Not only running with the story, running to try and back it up. It doesn't go well. The police search the Wendrow's home and computers for those naked pictures. They find none. They take Aislinn for a medical exam. The nurse reports she observes no acute injuries.
It made absolutely no sense. And I truly thought this is just a horrible misunderstanding and it's gonna be fixed.
Somebody's birthday party.
Tolly was confident because after so many years of trying to help Aislinn, there is one clear contradiction at the heart of these allegations.
If you've got a kid who can't talk and you are abusing that child, you don't fight so hard to make that kid talk.
And other people are already questioning the heart of the case, that Aislinn is able to communicate at all. Brazier says as soon as her first story on the Wendrows ran, she got a call from one of Aislinn's former teachers.
And she said, there is no way that this child's able to type. And I said, that's not what the police are saying or the prosecutors. And she said, if you said to Aislinn, point to the sky, the child would not be able to do that.
I'm going to write an A. I'll write a B.
When I met with Aislinn, there was no facilitated communication. So unlike the investigators, I got to see how Aislinn would respond without someone helping.
This is an A. Which is the B? Aislinn, point to the B for me. That's an A.
The obvious question, if she can't identify letters, how can she spell? And if she can't spell, how could she write?
This is a C, that's the B, that's right.
The only conclusion is, well, then she never could have said anything through FC. She couldn't have typed.
It all leads to one disturbing conclusion, a conclusion scientists have been reaching for years. Facilitated communication is fake. Long before this case, studies had found repeatedly kids weren't actually revealing inner thoughts using FC. The facilitators were typing for them, leading the child's hand, like a psychic over a Ouija board. But wait a minute. If Aislinn wasn't typing those allegations, it meant Scarcella was. How and why would she do that? But first, things take a much darker turn.
Bullshit, man. You know what's going on because you've experienced it firsthand.
Aislinn's 13-year-old brother Ian is about to be dragged into the investigation. In a police interview, you have to see to believe.